So following in the previous footsteps of the video on pivots, I'm going to talk a little bit more about pivots. And this time, rather than talking about temporary pivots, I'm going to talk about permanent pivot changes. So if I go ahead and press D, of course, I have access to this. If I were to hit insert, it's again the same tool. It's just a different presentation. D works for as long as you're holding down the D key, whereas insert, you press it once and it goes into the tool. So if I take this and I move it out, click the little guy here and change the pivot, and it appears to have worked. It appears to have changed the orientation as well as the position. However, this is not the case. If I look at this, the custom orientation is actually the only thing that's changed there. The pivot has been changed, but not its orientation. The actual orientation is still there. So if I want to use it in actual object mode, sort of like a more permanent change, because if I were to use that custom axis and let's say create a new object here, you notice that that new object also has that same custom axis because that's on the tool, it's not on the object itself. And each one should have their own individual orientation. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to just actually quickly reset that, and I'm going to create a locator and make believe that this is my actual orientation. So this guy, local, there we go. Move that out. I'm going to make this a child. That's the parent. Press P. I'm going to do a modify freeze transformation. So now we'll talk about this in just a moment. It's going to freeze my orientation. And I'm going to hold down D as in dog, V as in Victor. I'm going to snap that center to the locator. Shift P to unparent it, and then delete the locator. So now you'll notice that this is in actual object mode, and the pivot and the orientation are different. So while in Softimage you would have just clicked on the center and been able to do that directly, this is sort of a fix to be able to work around that missing feature inside of here. Now, freeze transformations, what is the general purpose of this? Well, go ahead and modify freeze transformations. Modify center pivot, get it back to kind of normal. Take this up, modify freeze transformations. Again, it zeroes out. The idea here is that it's sort of a relative position to return that back to where it needs to be. Another point at which it becomes an issue, let's just duplicate that off. Take this guy and I'm going to scale it non-uniformly. Child parent, press P. And even though I didn't scale this guy, you're going to notice that there's now a smaller scale value here. And that's because it's trying to negate the scale values that are on the parent, which is being passed on to the child. The child's inherited that information. It only really becomes revealed when you try and orient this. So if you're trying to make, you know, an engine or something like that, it would start to reveal these problems. So I'm just going to return that to zero. Grab this guy, modify freeze transformations, and lo and behold, it functions as usual. So the freeze transformations has the ability to basically zero out translation, rotation, and scale without actually changing the main information here. So the location of the pivot as well as the location of the points remains consistent. Only the orientation of the pivot is actually flattened out. So if I were to rotate this and freeze it, rotation would be flattened out, but its pivot location remains the same, even though that's been zeroed out. So that's how that functions. And of course, you can choose to not do translation or rotation and just use scale if you like. Now let's quickly talk about some of the alignment tools. So let's say that I've got my little object here, and say someone's created this little scene and they needed the character's ship to rise up and fly off. But the alignment now of the ship is no longer correct. So as a result, I need to have the alignment repaired. If I happen to have a previous version of it, so much the better. I could just simply replace it with this one. But say this was one that didn't have proper UVs or something like that. I could also go ahead and try and replace this with this guy here, duplicate him off, snap him to him and back and forth. I'm just going to do it in the one direction here. I'm just going to take this guy and actually replace him. I'm going to do that by going ahead and let's select three vertices on this guy, and then the same three vertices, shift, select, vertex, shift, add to the selection, same selection order, modify, align, and I'm going to align 3 points. I have point to point, 2 points, and 3 points. So basically all the same thing. It's just how many points to use for the actual alignment. That's perfectly aligned it up. And what you'll see here is that I have the ship with the poor alignment and the ship with the good alignment. So I'll take the one with the poor alignment, throw it away. Got the good alignment one here. And now if I need to pass it off to an animator, they can go ahead and flatten it out and travel along its proper angles. So some other alignment tools. Say you were creating a street corner or something like that, and what you wanted to do was to lay down a bunch of barrels or something. I have the snap together tool, which is one of my favorite tools here. I'm just click, press enter. Just going to G to repeat that command. Click, enter. Of course, this can be done on pretty much any kind of surface. And it will align those 2 points together. Additionally, we have some other tools in here. Grab the two of them, modify, and then I'm going to go to the align objects, which is going to align them. The align objects will, of course, also have some features. So if we go into it, we have basically going to the average or to the last object selected. We have going to the center, which is what's happened here. They've met in the middle, or to the minimal point or maximum point. And then there's distance and stacking. So you can play with those if you wish. They also have filters to say, to only align in say one or two axes specifically, but not into the others, so that you can set those guys up as well. In addition to this, we have another tool. Just quickly show you that one. I'll just click this a few times. So there's a bunch there. Select him. And then position along curve. Apparently I didn't have as many as I thought. Just pressing it too fast. And this is a long curve, and it'll try and place them based on the point positions, the weighting. I put more distance here, so more distance is between them. And that will position them along the curves. Now, one more feature here. Take this object, move it up here, align it, Now, typically speaking, we would have a match transforms kind of availability inside of Softimage. We take this object, we grab this one, and we'd match its transforms. One of the easiest ways, of course, to do this inside of Maya is not with that tool because it doesn't directly exist. We have many alignment tools, but what we can do is simply just child parent and press P. And of course, if we wanted to match orientation or position, it's really easy to choose that. And of course, we can do both at the same time just by simply selecting those and then grabbing this object and unparenting it, and then it's exactly where it needs to be. Another way which you can do this is by using constraints, which is another old school way of doing pretty much the same thing and can be easily scripted just the same as the parenting one, and essentially just master slave and then go to your animation constrain point, constrain orient, and remove target. What it does is it basically applies a constraint for both the position and orientation, and then removes that constraint from the object, just leaving it as is. So this is a common tool people will create really quickly, and then they'll dump it on their timeline. So that's some information about pivots and some alignment tools that you can use here inside of Maya. And hopefully that's been helpful.